Welcome back to the 27 and to the North Loop. Today we're in the Porsche 911 GT3R taking our second serious look at the Nordschleife. You would have to be some sort of a Muppet to have a serious or somewhat serious sim racing YouTube channel and not come here. There is a spiritualness surrounding this track in both real life and sim racing circles, and I'm beginning to get it. People interested in Nordschleife videos are a different breed of sim racer. Those that appreciate the aspects of racing that aren't necessarily racing at all. Or, how do I explain this? It's about racing, but mostly one particular aspect of it. From what I can tell, and I'd hope you'd agree, it's about the pursuit of perfection. You don't have to be racing other cars. You're racing against yourself. So I'm not going to try and pull a cloak over your eyes and pretend I'm an expert here. I'm not. I'm not going to give you a turn-by-turn breakdown of the North Loop because it's so grand. We're going to be talking about the Porsche in general, in particular, what I've learned about the Porsche recently. We'll look at some telemetry, but to be honest, it's data overload. There are so many things going on at Nords that there's no setup tricks here. Instead, it's about a solid foundation. We're going to be playing fundamental baseball. As a member of Flashpoint Esports, the motorsports division, I work closely with the Nemesis 69 with his race builds, and we are doing this because we both anticipate AMS2 becoming a feature platform for sim racing esports. In that effort, we've been working on the Porsche GT3R pretty seriously for the past 3 weeks or so. There is one thing to make a race build for a car that is comfortable for me, with the hopes that you feel the same way. It's a whole another challenge to make a build for someone who can take the car places that most of us can only dream of. But what I'm learning from him helps me get to know the car better. Specifically, I'm not trying to bring the cars to me as much, so to speak, but instead that each car has its own way to be driven on its limits, and I'm focusing my setups in that direction more and more now. There's no better example of this than the Porsche GT3R in the GT3 category. If you're watching this, you might already have tons of experience with the Nordschleife, every corner with many different vehicles across multiple sim racing platforms, so you're trying to squeeze an extra second out of it if you can. Perhaps you have years of experience, but then again, you might not. So I've done the research, real life, other sim racing platforms, you name it. And to be completely honest with you, AMS2 is right there as far as Porsche 911 GT3R performance expectations. So let's dig into it. It's a rear engine vehicle, so it's on its limits, it's a peculiar car. It features really great early corner rotation, a very planted rear end, great acceleration. It relies on the weight shift to the front to turn the car into the corner, but after that is what the Porsche is all about. Things begin to get tricky mid-corner. As you hit the accelerator, the weight shifts back to the rear, and the car doesn't want to turn that much anymore, which scrubs the fronts depending on the corner. Also, it can be sensitive to throttle adjustments in this transition period, so getting the dampers just right, getting the springs just right, the ARBs, actually getting everything just right is important. The goal is to dive deeper into the corner, not taking a direct line with other like you would with other cars. You trail brake, rotate the car early, then get on the throttle early for the exit. For longer corners, and in particular high speed ones, the Porsche will struggle. You might have to actually go through multiple phases of rotation with the apex as deep as possible. The goal is to limit the scrubbing of the fronts on exit and instead to be rotated and on the power when you get to it. Knowing this, you may think that setup-wise, making adjustments to encourage rotation are a good thing, and they are, but going overboard can be just as bad, if not worse, because you would be creating an unwanted, instable car mid-corner, and therefore you can't get on the power as effectively, which is what the build and the car is all about. You want the car to bite on corner entry, but not too much. You want a smooth, predictable rotation. You want the car to stabilize and then go. That's the Porsche in a nutshell. The primary tools that I use to create rotation are softer front springs, appropriate front cambering, a higher rake value, and a stiffer rear damping package. We are not going to use toe, as toe may help with turn in, but hurt on corner exit. We are not using the coast ramp differential for rotation off throttle. We need that for stability. And finally, our front dampers are on the stiff side as well. We need a quick reacting front end with a weight transfer, but instant stability after that. We are not looking for a deep bite and a deep grip going through the entire corner. The more you try to get the car rotated the later in the corner, the more trouble you're going to have. So let's take a look at the telemetry. Racing Sim Tools. So let's take a look at everything. Like I said, data overload. Take a look at this. Make any sense of it? This is insane. Okay, so when you get circumstances like this, looking at telemetry, you really can't focus on just like, there's not like 10 corners, there's 100. So it can get a little bit messy. What we're looking at now is sort of like generalities. So you can see that we're looking at the component wheel load section of the default build right now. The green represents the activity of the dampers, the red indicates the springs, the blue, the ARBs. We have the default build, I have the alpha build, and then I have my my beta build. I guess you could say the one that's going to be at the end of this video. So you can see that there's a change in all of the activity between each of the builds. So the first one, you can see that the defaults rely a little bit more on the ARBs on the front. The alpha does not, but the beta comes in and starts using ARBs again. The one other thing I want to point out here is the damper activity, the green. You can see that the default build has a lot less damper activity than the beta build. So you could see that's a ton of damper activity. I didn't want that much damper activity. You want a smooth car, a non-bouncy car. So I did some changes and I brought the damping back a little bit, not too much, because we did need it for other purposes, but the big change here was the ARBs. Also look at the activity of the springs. You know, they fluctuate a lot more with the beta build, whereas they're back within reason. It's not ever going to be perfect, but you can zoom in, obviously, and you can get the gist of things. But let's move on to the differential tab. This is what I usually start off with, looking back at the default build. I felt like it was a good differential package by default. You can see down here in the wheel differential line that it opens up quite consistently. At some point it goes over 10 to 15% here and there. I like a more locked build, so let's look at the beta, and you can see that it's generally the same, with some opening on tighter corners, and generally you want to keep it everything within that 10% range. The brake bias, I know from the Porsche that I prefer a more forward bias as opposed to the default build. That alleviates that instability in early entry corner rotation that you're looking for. I created it with the suspension. If you like the brake bias instability, feel free to keep the default package. You don't have to do changes that I recommend on this page. They're very minor anyway. Let's look at the suspension, the damper histograms for the default build. Here we have the rebound side, the bump side for the front left, rear left, front right, rear right. And really it's the differences that we're going to be paying attention to. Let's look directly at the beta. A lot stiffer on the front, a lot stiffer on the rear as well. I thought not that much on the rear, but I thought with the Porsche, to create that rotation, we needed to increase the bump bias on the front and increase the rebound bias on the rear. That's why you see this bias reflected on the charts. With the default build, it's a little bit less aggravated. So these damper histograms, you treat them as an ideal cone conical shape if you want everything to be balanced all the same. But that's not the end of the story. You want to also shape the car's behavior with the transitions using the dampers, and that's what we did here. Looking at the gearing, I think an interesting aspect of it, you could see the power curve really quite apparent for the Porsche. But the difference between the beta build and the alpha build, these red bars down here, you want them to be as low as possible. That means you're on throttle more if they're lower. And you can see I did that with the alpha build and it gained me 2 seconds, almost 2 seconds. That was a big factor. Aero package, not much to glean from this except for that I increased the rake with the beta. The default build has, I think a normal, what you would expect from the Porsche. We maybe lost a little bit of downforce with the beta, but at the same time, we add that control and comfort. And really all that matters with as far as downforce is concerned is in these spots where they don't register data, where, the downforce is, there's no real data being collected at low speeds, which is when you arguably need it the most. The high speed analysis is nice, but you can also see here, I'm going to point this out, the center of pressure changes with the default and the alpha and then the beta. They're just slight and subtle, but these up and down oscillations are basically the car bumping up and down. So looking at it as a whole, it looks like a big mess. My goodness gracious, I don't even know why we're looking at this. But you can see the subtle difference in rake. But that rake allows that rotation, which allows us to get on the power earlier. Okay, so moving to the temperatures, we're looking at the brakes here, everything all well and good, like I said. You can adjust this for preference. I think the defaults are just fine here. The tire temperatures, that's an interesting one. I thought the defaults did a pretty good job with tire temperatures. It looked like the cambering may be a little bit off from the front light with the front right with the defaults, a little high comparatively. The skew was okay within acceptable ranges. The pressures were off by about half a degree. Now that's going to be hard to tell or recognize by the naked eye, but this is the benefits of having telemetry. With the beta build, I brought the cambering back into reason. The skew stayed the same. The pressures generally the same. But then, let's look at the beta build. Cleaned it up. I made it as best as possible. Brought the rears at least in the perfect contact patch. Skew is a little bit different because of the cambering. Let's look at the absolute tire temperatures. This is also informative. So here we have the default build. You have a front left at 78 and a rear left at 80, which is right in the range of what you're looking for. You want to have that 5 degree C difference. Here with the alpha, it's about 4 degrees. And then with the beta, we're looking at 3 degrees. So there's really no difference here. And the wear will reflect this too. Unfortunately, I can't show the run graph because I didn't register enough consecutive laps. Finally, let's look at the track. I think this is a little bit informative as well, particularly the differential locking tab. And this is basically a grand overview of where your car is locking and unlocking. What you want to do is you want to avoid these red sections. Now, it's hard because the red sections could indicate curb work. All right, let's click on the custom. And you can see that there's a lot less red. There are some spots of red, but a lot less compared to the defaults. That's the coast and the power ramp, being locked. That's what it gives you. And that's why I do it. So that's the Porsche GT3R at Nordschleife, the North Loop. I have an alpha build on the leaderboard, so look for that. It's in the 644 range, which is, top 16%, which is traditionally where I fall on the leaderboards with my skill set. What you'll see here is my beta build. Feel free to try them both. I think I had a banger of a lap with the alpha build, but I didn't like the telemetry, so I kept tinkering with it. At some point, I will head back and get this build on the boards for you, but I just wanted to let you know, the alpha build is close. There were some damping changes. If you try either of the builds and you struggle with lap times, let me know. I love hearing feedback. If there's something that you are struggling with the build that you feel the default does better, let me know as well. Let's start a conversation, you and I. The personalized livery here was provided by Big Rig NZ. Thank you, Big. You can meet him by joining the Steelcast 27 Racing Network. Discord information is below. Coming up, we'll have Super V8 custom default build, and it was a game changer for me. I avoided that car like the plague since I first touched it a couple of months ago. It's completely different now, and wow, such a unique car to drive. If you enjoyed the video or the build, make sure to clickety all the clickety clicks. Until next time, take care.